artificial intelligence and machine learning are obviously very hot topics these days, but there are challenges getting going, and there are innovations that are popping up all over the place. We're going to be talking about some of these things in this series and focusing on particular areas like automotive. So, Seth, can you share an overview of what we're going to learn in this series and discuss the intersection of, say, AI and simulation with respect to the auto industry?
Yeah, sure, Bill. So AI and simulation are both very well-established applications at this point, but they come from two different fields. So AI comes more from the computer science field, simulation more a tool that engineers are familiar with. And so, in these interviews, what I'm really kind of hoping to address is, you know, from an engineer's perspective, how can AI help them? How can they combine AI with simulation? Where are some applications and places where we're seeing users successfully combining these two technologies, and what's that look like?
So AI is becoming ubiquitous across the engineering application space. Why is this important now in the auto industry?
Yeah, so I think the auto industry has a couple of really good things going for it when it comes to adopting AI. You know, one is there's just tons and tons of data available. There's so much telemetry available from vehicles, you know, whether those be test fleets with really high fidelity telemetry and all sorts of data available, or even in production fleets, we're starting to see more and more telemetry data come through from them. And so in order to build AI models, you need data. And there's the automotive industry is definitely, I would call it data rich. The other thing I think that's going on is AI as a technology has really matured in the last few years. So there's been a lot of new tools that lower the bar for applying AI. MATLAB and Simulink being a couple of those, and so it's more approachable from an engineer's point of view now as well.
Okay, well, MATLAB and Simulink are things that we've been using a lot now. How are these changing? How are they essentially new tools these days?
Yeah, so what we've been doing is we've been adding a whole host of different capabilities to our products at MathWorks. And so these can be anything from new point-and-click apps that make it easier to bring in your data, try some different types of AI models, and really get an understanding for, is AI appropriate for the data or the problem that I'm trying to solve? So we've really been kind of focusing on, smoothing out and easing those workflows for exploring AI and how it might apply to a problem. The other thing that we've been doing is adding more support kind of throughout, our full tool chain or workflow for AI models. And so, all the way through to things like embedded code generation and being able to do that from these higher level AI models. So it's really, it's not just building the AI models, it's ensuring that they work well with the full tool chain that we're providing.
Okay, so how can you help designers build effective AI models? They're going to have to essentially learn some new technologies and when they're doing this.
Yeah, definitely. So I think, one of the first, kind of steps is identifying places where AI can help. And, in that regard, it's kind of good to look out there and see, in the research or, and on the web and see, where are some applications where people have successfully used AI in automotive contexts. We have a couple of, user presentations that I've seen recently from MathWorks users that talk about applying it to battery management systems, exhaust gas systems, perception systems. So it's really, there's really kind of opportunities for it in all sorts of different kind of roles within the automotive R&D sector. Another great way to kind of understand where you might apply AI is to, is to increase your own skills in AI. And so there's a whole host of resources out there for, what we call upskilling in AI, right? So kind of taking some training courses and, really improving your understanding of what the AI techniques look like, what it means to apply those, what types of issues you might run in when you go to do that. So I think that's another, kind of key way to understand what's possible is to, get a better understanding of what's the underlying technology.
Okay. What are some of the obstacles and challenges that engineers are going to encounter in incorporating AI into vehicle systems design and even their R&D workflows?
Yeah, that's a really great question. You know, the larger world of AI is historically a world of servers and clouds, and a world where close enough might be okay. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be 100% accurate, which is very different than, you know, what needs to happen on a vehicle. And so, you know, it's not about a world of servers and clouds. It's how can I fit this onto an ECU or some embedded processor running on the vehicle? And so one of the big obstacles we see people going through is how can I get an AI model small enough and performant enough to run on the vehicle on some, you know, much lower cost embedded processor. And so, you know, you might start a project to incorporate AI. You're just kind of, you know, working on it on, say, your desktop, or maybe you're using some cloud resources to train models. And early on, you're really focused on accuracy, right? You're just trying to figure out, can I get an AI model to predict this thing well enough? But then when it comes time to think, well, how do we run this on the vehicle? It's a very different set of challenges. You're really concerned about footprint. You're concerned about how can I, you know, now take this model. Maybe I use some model that I found in the research, but that model is, you know, hundreds of megabytes, and I'm not, you know, maybe I don't want to add that much RAM to the vehicle. And so how can I make that model smaller? So these are things we call like model compression techniques, pruning, quantization. How can I reduce the size of it while keeping that accuracy that I saw that got me so excited and positive about AI as a viable solution here? And then kind of another step that's, you know, kind of as you go to on vehicle is verification and validation. And this is, you know, this whole verification and validation of AI models is very much a rapidly evolving area. It's a big focus of research. You know, how can we gain a really concrete understanding of what the AI models do, how they're going to perform, so that we can get confidence that we're, you know, that it's safe to deploy these into production. And so there's techniques out there right now around explainability and interpretability that kind of help engineers understand why is a model making the decisions that it makes, and you can use those to kind of dig into things. But I expect this will be an area where we will continue to see a lot more innovation and new techniques being developed as the industry standards bodies kind of come out with more guidance on how to verify and validate AI models.
Okay. Well, one of the aspects that you're involved with is simulation. And obviously, both simulating an AI environment and simulating the actual testing. Could you talk a little bit more how those things work together?
Yeah, definitely. So I think, you know, one of the real key steps in building an AI model that's going to run on a vehicle is, you know, kind of incorporating the AI model into a vehicle simulation. And that really helps you understand how does the AI model perform when it's interacting with the rest of the vehicle systems. So again, it's kind of that transition from early on, you're probably developing the AI model a bit in isolation. You're really concerned with what type of a model am I going to use? What's the architecture of the model look like? Can I come up with an architecture that gets me good enough accuracy or performance to meet the requirements of the, you know, the accuracy requirements of my application. And so it's that transition from working in that environment to now I need to integrate this with my simulation. I want to understand how does it work when it's interacting with the rest of these in kind of like a real time or a streaming kind of type of application where there's continuous data streams coming in. It's also an opportunity to look at things like code generation and how does this model perform when I generate code. You know, a key capability of Simulink for model-based design for years has been our automatic code generation, that ability to go from a higher level block diagram environment to the lower level C or C++ code, you know, with a few button clicks. And so that, you know, being able to do that for these AI models is, you know, just as important as it is for a lot of these, you know, other parts of the algorithms that are running on the vehicles. It's, you know, you don't want to have to hand it off to somebody else to manually recode it into another language, potentially introducing errors or inconsistencies. And then especially in the field of AI, where the models are so rapidly evolving, you know, if next week you say, wait, stop recoding that one, I have a better model that I want to move to production with, you know, that's not going to be very efficient if you're having to hand it off to some other team to re-implement it. So I think the world of what you get through simulation is really that ability to keep up with the pace of changes to the AI model and get confidence that it's going, those changes can flow through the rest of your model-based design workflow.
Okay. Well, can you share any examples of utilizing AI simulation in the automotive space?
Yeah, so a couple of recent ones that I saw that I thought were really exciting. One was Goshen. So they were using MATLAB and Simulink for battery state of charge or SOC estimation. And so with SOC estimation, you're trying to, you know, use the sensors that are available on the battery, things like voltage, current, temperature sensors, to estimate how much charge is left in the battery. Historically, that's been done using techniques like Kalman filters, and those are still very popular today. But Goshen wanted to see, could we do this with an AI model? And so, you know, they kind of started from more of a requirements point of view. So the AI model would need to be, you know, so much, you know, be a certain amount, have a certain amount of accuracy, have a, you know, a allowable footprint to fit on the BMS, on the battery management system. And so they started with some requirements around those. They gathered data, they built models in MATLAB, they trained different machine learning models, they simulated those models with the rest of the BMS system. And then they went all the way through to embedded code generation with embedded coder. And so I think the thing that to me that was most exciting about that was, you know, kind of seeing AI go all the way through this model-based design workflow and being able to validate that, you know, the requirements were met even when you got down to the you know, final code generation level. They also did some really kind of impressive work with choosing an architecture where the footprint was, you know, kind of on the order of kilobytes, not on the order of megabytes or gigabytes like we're used to seeing in a lot of these larger AI models. So I thought that was a really cool application. Another one that comes to mind was from Stellantis. So they used MATLAB and Simulink for a NOx estimation application. So they were trying to estimate what's the NOx concentration in the tailpipe. And they had an existing physics-based model of this in a third-party like computer-aided engineering tool that they had this powertrain and engine model. And they wanted to see, could they estimate the NOx in the tailpipe that was coming from that simulation, but using kind of what we call a reduced order model. So instead of using this full physics-based model that's high fidelity, but also takes a really long time to compute, could they approximate that with an AI model? And so it's that kind of notion of reducing the order of the model, but really you're just kind of approximating this physics-based model with an AI model. And so to do that, they interfaced MATLAB and Simulink with this other computer-aided engineering tool that they were using. Again, they collected data, they trained some models, and they were able to show that they were able to estimate that NOx concentration quite well with an AI model that evaluated many, many times faster than the physics-based model that they had started with. So I thought that was, you know, a really cool application as well, because you're approximating this thing that you have more confidence in, that you know has all these, you know, the laws of physics and things like that, you're approximating it with an AI model that really can serve as a great tool for design, because now I can run all sorts of, you know, parameter sweeps or optimizations of my system using this AI model in the loop that's much faster to evaluate. But they even took it a step further, and they're looking at using this AI model as actually like a redundant system on the vehicle to verify that the readings coming from the NOx sensor on the vehicle are, you know, matching what the AI model is saying they should be, with the eventual goal of maybe even looking at, could they reduce the number of NOx sensors on the vehicle? So replacing hardware with software. So so that's a pretty cool application, I thought, as well.
Well, very good. Well, we're going to wrap up the first part right now, but we're going to be looking forward to the second part in the near future. Thanks very much, Seth.
Yep. Thanks, Bill.